section was designed and written originally, Meditation and Mindfulness, the two interwoven components of the Buddha's successful meditation. And we're, what it is, it takes you and in, hooks it into the dependent origination. There's so many times you could write about this topic and the dependent origination, and always with the effort to try to show you how you can pull this together and weave it into a tapestry so it's hooked together. Now, I should ask you maybe before I start, if you have any questions that you want to ask from last time. Does anybody have questions? No, not yet? Okay. So the topic here, as it's described, is meditation and mindfulness. They're two interwoven components of the Buddha's successful meditation, so that you can become able to observe more closely the process of the human cognition, which he called dependent origination, and also become aware of the three characteristics of existence. This is important too. And what's that gonna say? That's all right, it'll come back. Okay, I want you to think about something for just a moment. What was the Buddha's meditation, which he taught? What was it really for? And one of the things, I'm not sure if it was here, but it, we need to remember it was the beginning of you discovering that you can communicate with your brain. And that means your intentions can be set firmly and your brain follows the instructions. So what was the Buddhist meditation taught really for? We are going to begin to take a closer look into both meditation and mindfulness to get a very clear understanding of their interwoven relationship with each other. In the time of Buddha Gautama, meditation brought out about more peaceful living for millions of people. And how did that happen? How did this happen? These are things you think about as you're going through this. Do you ever wonder how practicing meditation can change your life? How does it work? It's a perfectly reasonable question, isn't it? Because you might wonder, will I see and understand something I don't normally learn about that will become a useful tool in my life? That's what you're asking yourself. Now, during training, in order to grow your knowledge, it's important to ask questions and to uncover the answers that you can easily comprehend yourself. So the whole time we're learning this, what we're all doing is looking for ways, easier ways to explain it that people can easily understand. In fact, we are finally witnessing the true nature of everything. And as our old confusion fades away, many previous subjects presenting fear and dread about life, they disappear. And when you see the truth of life as it actually is, then you uncover a major key to living more easily through this existence. But how does it happen? That's what Q always asks, how does it happen? Well, in part one, you know, this is what is the meditation and what is mindfulness? And we say first, what is Buddhist meditation? Then we say, what is mindfulness? Then three, we say, how does it support our meditation, the mindfulness? And then what are we attempting to discover precisely? So how do we reduce suffering by using the knowledge of dependent origination and these definitions and such? How does it work? So number one, what is Buddhist meditation? Well, near as I can figure out after 20 years, Buddhist meditation was and still is, it can be an excellent practice of observing the movements of mind's attention in order to see clearly the true nature of how everything actually works in life. we get to observe the Four Noble Truths in action every time that we are doing the six R's. We actually experience this. We understand and witness dependent origination as it is occurring during individual events in life, and deeply comprehend the three characteristics of existence. And Q asks, is there a shorter version of this that we can remember? Of course. Try this. Buddhist meditation is observing the movement of mind's attention in order to see and understand how all kinds of suffering happen in life. We get to see the true nature of everything. And he says, okay, what is the difference between seeing something and understanding something? Well, a person can see something happen one time, but they can only deeply understand it internally when they watch it up close many times over. This is because of how the brain works. This is what this means. And that is the only way that they can learn how this really works. In meditation, if the meditator is not taught the proper instructions for the meditation, then they might keep on blindly sitting for a very long time. But this is not what the Buddha was doing at all. He had a goal, an objective, you could say. He had a special kind of investigative practice to reach the objective, and his methodology was perfect, and it still is. And there is plenty of information in the suttas that can help you reach the same objective or goal. If we answer one question, it might make it easier to begin to meditate correctly. Now, what is mindfulness? That's one of the questions. Mindfulness is a skilled observation that we learn. We must keep going all the time in order for us to be able to witness the true nature of everything. Mindfulness has a talent for remembering certain things that help us perfect our practice. So what does it remember? It remembers, it helps us to remember to keep our observation going all the time. How does this support our meditation? Well, during our meditation, mindfulness remembers the four steps of right effort whenever they are needed. It reminds us to do all the steps correctly. It reminds us not to leave any of the steps out, so we both purify and retrain our mind each time we practice the right effort cycle. We won't get hung up in our practice if we keep sharp mindfulness present all the time. Now, practicing right effort effectively, it purifies and retrains your mind. And it helps us create new neural pathways in our brain to replace older, unwholesome ones that caused suffering before. Instead of holding on to what caused the older suffering, we replace the unwholesome mind states with new wholesome mind states. And that forms more effective, wholesome behavior. Ongoing mindfulness outside of formal meditation sitting helps us to focus on tasks more easily and smile until they are done. Whenever you use applied mindfulness, and you are using, at that time, you are using an impersonal perspective. And that's what you start to pay attention to and discover that life's a lot better if you don't take things so personally and you don't get so serious. So number four, what are we attempting to discover? We're attempting to see how everything you experience in life works. Now, some very good Buddhist scholars have called this realizing the actuality. When we keep referring to the true nature of how everything is, what does that really mean? You will eventually apply your practice to whatever is happening in life. That's the assumption, as it's occurring. Because of what you learn here, you will have an edge over anyone else who does not understand the actuality. This means you will have some insight information many people never learn. It has to do with discussions, with relationships, with business, with making deals, just everything you can think of in life, this can apply to. And this helps people let go of fear, sloth and torpor, restlessness, and above all, doubt. And so this releasing of the hindrances by tuning yourself to the proper knowledge that tells you how everything works. There is an expression in one movie, The Wizard of Oz. In the movie, finally, Dorothy, the star, she gets to see the man behind the curtain. Suddenly, it was running everything in the story. She realizes that there was no wizard there. And this is just like there is not Nibbana in a box. You might do the work in your meditation and comprehension training to achieve the right condition for cessation to happen so that you can then experience Nibbana. But there are no shortcuts. I can't find it, you know, and say to you, okay, here it is, it's in this package and it's 1995. Nibbana, the solution to everything. And it doesn't work that way. So what exactly is the meditator doing? The meditator is trying to develop a non-judgmental observation skill. So this is so they can clearly see how suffering happens, and gradually we are able to witness remarkable states that were just underneath what we thought was our state in life. This practice becomes your beginning for stepping out of a conventional reality into an ultimate reality. So we live in the conventional reality, but we study the ultimate reality, which is the higher potential for us to deal with people in our behavior in life. We will discover how consciousness cognizes, understands the individual steps within life events that are happening day in and day out. And we will keep moving down the same life continuum line that we were on. But now we will begin to look deeper and deeper into how everything operates. This reduces the draining energy that is caused by many disturbing emotional states. We'll notice a unique relationship between the steps of the Four Noble Truths. As we are doing our investigation into how human cognition works. The human cognition that is studied today is nearly identical to what the Buddha found over 2600 years ago. And he called this dependent origination or dependent co-arising. You can choose the translation. And this impersonal process should be learned first by meeting and understanding individual links that we are able to see during the progress of one event in life at a time. Now, the Buddha found 12 causal links and realized how none of the links had any part of a previous link in them. It's interesting, people don't understand that. Sometimes they look at this line of links and they compound it, like compounding interest or something. They look at the first link and think that when they get to the second part of the first one's in the second, and then those two are in the third, there's a part of them in there. But let me ask you, here's a kind of simile for you to understand how it works. You see, if you were on a staircase and you were at the top of the staircase and you were walking down, or at the bottom walking up, you can do it either way in your mind. When you step on the first step to get to the second step, is there any part of the first step on the staircase in the second step? There isn't. You just needed the first step to get to the second step. When you think of it that way, Professor Karuna Dasa figured out this is really true, that there is no part of the one previous one that had to happen for the existence of the next one, but there's no part of that one continuously being there inside that next link. So these links happen thousands of times a day during life events. It is only through direct knowledge. The meditator realizes that these can be sensed, and those links causing tension and tightness can be released by using the six R's in our practice for a perfect routine escape from daily suffering. At first, when you begin to watch for this, it is not clear because it's rather difficult to see it. This is a case where you must first learn what you are looking for before you see it and let go. You learn and practice the names and functions of each one of the links in the process until you can sense the causal relationship. So when you begin to understand the chain and see this clearly, you are deeply glimpsing into the ultimate reality. Now you see the difference between conventional and the ultimate realities because of the difference in the levels of cognitive knowledges. Where a person is overcome so quickly by anger, you now know there are frames to edit within this one event. When a person is overcome by grief and incapacitated, you know that you can watch the cycle of arising grief, allow it to run through its course underneath whatever you are doing in life at the time, and that you will stop reacting due to having knowledge of anicca and continue your work without reacting. There is so much to learn with this knowledge and system. It opens all kinds of doors to understanding what stress and anxiety that exists in emotional points, conditions. The more you can let go of essential personal thoughts, ideas, assumptions, opinions, and just watch what happens instead, the easier it gets for you to see line of cognition as it is happening through each event. Now, at first, you will review what just happened just after it is over. Later on, you will be watching the links as they are happening. You will recognize them in other people as they are occurring. You are learning by way of an experiential path, just as the Buddha did with his monks. And the Buddha was a remarkable teacher. He kept reminding us of the importance of learning by way of knowledge and vision, which literally means knowing something by seeing it. Knowing by seeing is the same in his references to direct knowledge. They're the same thing. Now, when we actually are showing you, what we're doing, what we're actually showing you is how one arising phenomenological event can be observed and studied closely. Now, I gave you a big word, but it's a compound word, phenomenological. One phenomenon logically watched from the beginning to the end without opinions. That's all it is. Much suffering is caused by our ignorance of this knowledge about dependent origination. We were never taught how things actually work when we grew up. So this is like opening a secret door. In order to see how daily life events trick us into states of frustration and emotional outbursts, we only need to be carefully watching how 7 of the 12 links in the process operate. So this is where the training comes up. This is where the training chart that we give you comes in. The ones that are most important that you can watch in any event are contact as it happens, feeling, craving, clinging, habitual reactions, and the birth of those reactions. And I put reactions or actions because if you are already trained, you don't have reactions. At a certain level of your training, you start to only have actions happen. And it's like saying, we live by reacting when we're not trained, but then we start responding. So it's a difference between action and reaction. And the last one is the aging of the event, sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and despair, and the final death of the event. And the Buddha gave his monks this kind of training and meditation. It offers a remarkable access to the fact that no individual has anything happening to them. What is true is that when present time events occur, everything is happening from you. And you always have a choice what to do if you understand how this is operating. This is your untold power, mostly unused in the human species. Now, no one is the cause of their pain. No one is running the process. No one is making you suffer. It becomes clear that any formations arising are supported only by the energy from past actions, the karma, pushing things through, and how the formations are received by us. That part is entirely up to our perspective, and how we immediately see things in life. Do we see the positive, wholesome, helpful side, or do we assume the negative, unwholesome, downward side? Events impersonally arise in the present time, exist, but always pass away. And that's in Nietzsche. How do you receive your events at first? Check it out for yourself.